Yes. Break it down, y'all. Come on.
But anyway,
the hood dies young. Tell them about it, y'all. Hello, folks. Yes. Welcome to the George Mason Show. It's my man, Yah. I'm doing his thing up front. You heard? Uh-huh. Come on. Break it down. And I think the motherfuckers is loaded. Yeah. Tell them, Yah. That's my man. That's Yasin, Dr. Wright, Dr. Yasin Robert Wright, aka Yah. And I got a great show tonight. I'm excited. And Steve Solis, veteran comedian Steve Solis, and Dwayne Kennedy. Give it up for them. Both from Chi-Town. And I was going to talk about the weather with these brothers, but they're from Chicago, man. They don't even give a fuck. You know what I'm saying? Really? I'm not playing. I'm not going out like that. I'm not going to play myself on that area around there. But it's all good. And like I say, these brothers, man, they're professionals, stone cold professionals. And we're going to talk about the comedy business, just the business in general, and how things are done to some extent. And I want to talk about the black rooms, the white rooms, Berger, as far as like a lot of people don't understand what that is. You know, when I say black room or white rooms, or just it's comedy, but there's a whole pecking order, if you will. And I just want to touch briefly on that, some other stuff. You know, the internet is going crazy about the Cat Williams interview that he did with Shannon Sharp on Club Shay Shay, and which was great. I saw it and it was incredible. Cat, you know, did his thing as far as like just exposing the people, the business, if you will, the Illuminati. He got into a lot of areas and stuff, and it was very interesting. Funny too. It was very, very funny at the same time as being interesting. And I think Shannon got close to 50 million views. That's what we do here at the George Mason Show, roughly. We get that from time to time. But yeah, right. But it was all good. But you know what? And the show must go on. And Steve Solis is on his way, but we have a brother who, if you've never seen him or heard of him or whatever, I would suggest that you take time out and to Google who he is, and to, if he's in a city or town near you, check this brother out, because he's fantastic. He really is. And done Letterman, he's done Conan. He'll tell you about all his other exploits. He's got comedy albums out. He's done comedy specials on Showtime, HBO, and we got clips of that. I have clips of that, and I want to share that with you. He's all over. He tours. He does his thing. He works. He's a working comedian. And Without further ado, I'm talking about none other than Dwayne Kennedy. Huh?
Hey.
Yes. Welcome, Dwayne. Welcome.
Hey. Thanks for having me, George. How you doing?
I'm good, brother. Thank you. Yeah. You know, like I said, I was going to talk about the weather with you, man. But then you told me, I said, shit, he's from Chicago.
Right.
Don't even go there with them. You said when you left, it was 18 below?
It was 8 below zero when I left Chicago a few days ago. And it was supposed to get colder than that. So, yeah, I don't want to hear it.
Okay. All right. I'm not going there.
Because it's 20 here in New York?
In New York, yeah.
Yeah. See, we just getting started. 20 degrees, man. We coming out in the swimming trunks and the suntan lotion.
At 20.
At 20, yeah. When it warms up to 20, you know? Yeah.
Hey, Kim, on the check-in, Kim Roper, peace, salute to you as well, darling. And Dwayne Kennedy, I know she's here for you. And no doubt, that's what's up. But yo, Dwayne, and you know what, man? I was looking at some of your stuff, some of your work. Very impressed, always. We work together. And I, you know, back in the day, Steve had his room on West Side.
Right.
Yeah. That's why I seen you and Lance and Jetta Jones. And I think Rock used to come through there. When I say Rock, Chris Rock.
Yeah.
And I was impressed then.
At the West End, right? The West End.
West End I think it was West End Cafe.
Yeah.
And I said, these brothers were not only good, but, you know, just it's about 10 in Wisconsin. Hey, Karen. She's from Milwaukee. Karen Biden.
Okay.
Karen on the check-in. We got Poncho on the check-in.
Right.
Poncho is referred to as the Puerto Rican bad boy. And that's what so Poncho is getting. He's in the hospital now. And get well, Poncho. Poncho is a stern supporter of the show, as well as Karen and Kim. And we appreciate them.
Cool.
And Karen, I point out, she's a manager for rap artists. She's a white woman in Wisconsin. I probably say that. And nothing is fair. She's invited to the barbecue. Don't get it twisted. All right. Karen holds her own. She's down. She's okay. She was A&R and that kind of thing. So I play because, you know, Karen, you know, she could hold her own with the best, you know, from any hood. You feel me? She knows all about Chicago, Wisconsin. So you're right next door, right?
Yeah. I just did a show in Wisconsin last week. I was in, was it last week? Week before, I was in Kenosha, Wisconsin. Yeah.
Oh, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so
like you said, just across the state line.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it's no joke. I mean, and I want to show your special, well, what you your first Letterman appearance.
Okay.
Right? Is that cool?
Oh, absolutely, George. Do what, like I said, man. Show whatever you want to show. Ask me whatever you want to ask me, and you know. We'll see where it goes. Yeah.
All right, no doubt. I'm looking here. Who else is on the check-in? We got 774 people in here so far.
Oh,
774
wow.
On the
pretty
line.
Cool.
Kim says, wow. Yeah, that's what's up. Yeah, Kim. And this brother's deserving of it because he's incredible. He's phenomenal. He's a very, remind me of when I first saw you, of Richard, of the great Richard Pryor. And also, you know, style a little bit in the way you do your thing. Franklin Ajayi.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Franklin was always like, you know, he's one of my favorites, man. Remember he did that bit about the Olympics? About the dude.
Yeah, man.
I said, this is great, man. This is like a, you didn't even have to train to be last.
I done trained 4 years. I'm coming in last. You know, if I had never trained at all, I could have finished last. Yeah, man. Franklin is great.
Oh, he's great.
I met him, man, the first time I went to LA and I wound up doing a sitcom. I wound up working on 227.
Really?
Yeah. And Franklin was another, I did a guest episode. I was a guest on the episode, and Franklin also was a guest on the episode. That's where I met him. And over the years, I'd run into him. Like, we weren't tight friends, but I would run into him periodically, you know? Yeah.
Did he appreciate you?
I think so. I mean, when I met him, like I said, we met as, like, just actors in a sitcom. But then later years, I'd run into him. There's a club in Hermosa Beach, California called the Comedy and Magic Club. And he would perform there, and I would perform there. So he would see me and, you know, we would chat a little bit. Yeah.
Right. I of course perhaps, but yeah, so I want to show some pictures. Well, but you know what? I want to show your first Letterman appearance. Okay. and talk about it. And then I want to run some other pictures, your comedy album and stuff like that. But this is Dwayne Kennedy's first Letterman appearance.
Is making his debut with us tonight. He was voted best stand-up comedian at this year's Aspen Comedy Festival. Ladies and gentlemen, do me a favor. Please welcome Dwayne Kennedy. Oh, Dwayne.
Thank you. What's popping? How you feeling? I feel good, too. Thanks for asking. I've been reading the Bible, and this is what I have learned, is two things that they talk about in the Bible a lot. Wine and stuff that's hard to believe. I think the wine came first. And then thus, ergo, comes all the stuff that, you know, is kind of, you know, because you know how sometimes, man, you'll be drinking wine with a group of friends or, you know, some apostles. And, and a story will just start getting away from you. You know what I mean? Yeah, man, I remember yesterday I saw like a dog or like a beast when he had one or seven heads and the bush was on fire and talking to me. I'm drunk. But you can quote me on that. I hear you writing a book. I'm not real religious, man, but I do like gospel tunes. I like Negro spirituals, you know what I mean? I like Negroes with spirits, you know what I mean? I like Swing Low, Sweet Cherry. That's a brilliant song, man, but you have to listen to it because it had more than one meaning, you know what I mean? It was like, it was not just an ethereal aspiration to God. It also meant get ready because we get ready to get out of here. You know, that was the code. It was like Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. You know, the Underground Railroad is coming for to carry us home, you know what I mean? Or to Detroit or wherever it is you want to be dropped off, you know. And you got to think, it took a brilliant mind, man, to be able to write a song on that many levels, you know, because you know it was probably a lot of slaves who tried to write spirituals, but just wasn't really that good at concealing the message. And they'd be like, hey, Joshua, won't you sing that spiritual I hear you've been working on? All right, Master. Tonight at 8:30, gonna get some shovels and bash white folk in the head. What time? 8:30. Joshua's songwriting career over. But now people trying to find something, all right? People searching since whatever happened, you know what I mean? Searching for God or searching for Osama or, you know. Since they done offered $25 million reward, more people searching for Osama than God, you know what I mean? Just, now we're at war, you know. Not with a country, we're at war with an ideology, which is weird, man, because the only intriguing part about war, man, with the United States is you always see the new stuff that the United States has developed to wipe you out. Because it's not war, not like it used to be. Remember, war back in the day used to have some character, some flavor. Like, you remember, we probably don't remember this, but like the Revolutionary War? Right back then, you got a little music with your war. You know what I mean? Dude on drums, dude on fife, you know what I mean? A little background music while you're getting shot. You know, even the Civil War, they had a dude out there on bugle when you got there, you know? Welcome to the war. This next tune I wrote in Paris, I call this one Charge. Dude behind him playing bass, I don't know how we got this gig. But now, man, everything's high tech, you know? Everything is smart weapons, as opposed to, it used to be like just hope weapons, you know? Send a missile off, hope it would hit something. Right? Then the Persian Gulf War came out, remember that? And the smart weapons, remember that? Tomahawk missile, remember that? Flying this high off the ground, through the streets, dodging buildings, looking for your house. Any of you kids seen Dwayne? He lives right down the street, Mr. Missile, sir. All right, thanks. Stay in school. All right, you all. Thank you very much.
Oh, man.
Hey, George. How did that feel? How did that come up? Uh-huh.
I haven't seen that set since I did it.
Really?
Yeah, not the whole thing, no.
Not the whole stuff? Yeah. Bits and pieces, snippets of it.
Yeah,
hilarious. Just brilliant stuff. Funny stuff.
Thanks, man.
Just, yeah, oh, for sure. And I don't know. It's just like the writing, the way you put stuff together, the whole is just so. When I was watching like your special too,
mm-hmm.
You did the Showtime.
Yes.
And you write all your stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I write it all. Man. I mean, you know, it's one of those things like, you know, this as a comedian, you write. And sometimes somebody will say, oh, man, especially now with the internet, it's everybody throughout the whole world can put stuff online. So there's more people doing things. So sometimes you'll see something like, oh, man, I had an idea just like that, or I had a bit just like that. It's not even nobody stealing. It's just like parallel thoughts sometimes, you know?
Parallel thoughts. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes it's stealing. Don't get me wrong. But
sometimes. Yeah. Yeah.
But no, I write it myself, as far as I know.
That parallel thinking and situation can be scary.
Yeah.
I was at the West End years ago, and mm-hmm. his brother went up and did a bit. And, you know, if he had seen me, I was just starting out. Mm-hmm. I would have swore that, you know, he stole the stuff from me. But no, I didn't know the brother. Never mm-hmm. saw him. You never saw me, as far as I know. Mm-hmm. And it was almost like verbatim, like one piece. Yeah. Yeah. And that freaked me out. Now, I've heard of parallel thinking and thoughts and people saying, oh, I just steal that. And, you know, and I have walked into a room where I seen a brother up on stage mm-hmm. doing my stuff word for word. And I know he had took it because we worked out together.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, that kind of thing. But, yeah, so, you know, it's one of those situations. But, yeah, your stuff, if somebody takes your stuff, you know that it's stolen because nobody writes like that or thinks along those lines as far as I know, from what I've seen. I've been around the game for a little while now. So, you know that's Dwayne Kennedy's, that kind of thing, you know.
Man, yes, you know, and then you know how this goes too, George. Like sometimes it'll just depend if you're doing something topical. Mm-hmm. Everybody, you know, if it's a major thing, of course, that people might, a lot of people are going to maybe deal with that topic, but it didn't. Mm-hmm. It's the matter of what take do you have on it, you know?
How you put out there? It's a great shot there. I like this. Yeah. That's nice. Oh, man.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna play your. You say you once had a dream.
I once had a dream, brother. Those days are over. Those days are over with. I'm down to hopes.
Before I show you the next clip, I wanted to. Is this an album that you're working on or is out now?
I have two albums out.
You have two albums?
Yeah. I want to do another one. I was planning on recording it last fall, but that didn't happen. So maybe sometime this year, I'm still trying to figure that out.
Is that it there? Is that one of them?
Yes, that's the first one.
That's the first one?
Yeah, the EP, the album. Yeah.
And is a clip from...
I told you to get the hell out of here.
Man, why don't you go f*** yourself? How about that?
What's poppin'?
Oh, no. It's Dwayne Kennedy.
What's hey. Bob doing? Hey, Bob.
What up, man?
Man, that's funny, man. I was just talking to myself about you all this morning, yeah. And your names came up.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah, man, what you all doing?
We just make a little rundown to the spot.
Hey, you gonna finish that bagel?
Yeah,
you can. I mean, you can. Here you go, Bob.
Thank you, Bob. Yeah, but no, man, things are going good. I'm trying I got a CD.
Oh,
CD. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You've been talking about CD for what? A long time now.
15 years, 20 years. Right, maybe.
Yeah. That CD.
Yeah, it's that CD.
All right. It's a marathon, not a sprint.
Right. And I know it's been, 20, 25 years. But a lot of people are still angry at Reagan. You know what I mean? So right now, they're putting it online. They say it's going to be like on... I don't know, Etsy. Grindr and like Airbnb.
All right.
Yeah. So, Ali, you gonna finish that 20?
I hadn't really started using it yet.
All right, cool, Bob. Man. Thank you, man. I appreciate you. But so what are you all doing, man? What's going on?
Bad.
And gone with your fancy car and your $1 million Hollywood job, because you know what? I'm gonna be right here with my integrity, right? And my principles and my dignity. That's what I'm gonna be doing, standing here with my dignity. Ooh, a French fry.
Man. Oh, buddy.
Was that like with that piece there? Mm-hmm. Were you gonna like some type of show or like a pilot situation?
No, actually I did this just for the promotion of that album, but with the idea of maybe it could become something else later on. Which it just, it never did. But those are a couple of good friends of mine, the cat driving was Ali LaRoy, is Ali LaRoy. He's one of the the co-creators of Everybody Hates Chris. And he wrote on the Chris Rock show.
Oh, okay.
He was from Chicago as well. He was in a sketch comedy group called Mary Wong. And the brother in the passenger seat is Owen Smith. Owen is from PG County, Maryland, but we met in Chicago. Owen's a stand-up as well. And Owen also he was a showrunner on the last season of The Last OG, Tracy Morgan. And he's, you know, he's a writer in Hollywood and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, those
explain to everybody what a showrunner is.
A showrunner is a person that literally runs the show. Like on a sitcom, you see a showrunner. They're the ones that they put all the writers together and the producers and all that. They do all of that. So yeah, they run the show. And Ali was a showrunner on Everybody Hates Chris, and then like I said, and then Owen was a showrunner on the last season of The Last OG. So yeah, they run the show. You run the show. That's what you do.
It feels like they were like trying to like maybe come up and put something together, you know, to base around that, you know. Oh no, it's the, you know, that kind of
thing. You know, George, I don't know. We should have done something, man. Now, I mean, I wish you had been around then to suggest that. Like, yeah, that'd have been a good idea. So I don't know. Yeah.
You know what? It's never too late.
Yeah, you're right.
You know,
you're right.
Yeah.
So.
And you're here as well. Also, your partner, your buddy, and my buddy as well, Steve Solis.
Is he here? I'm supposed to be.
I don't know where he's at. But you guys have a gig coming up on the this Saturday, right? The 20th?
Yes. January 20th, yeah. Saturday, yep.
And this is Steve. He's been here before.
Yeah, that's my boy.
Yeah, that's Steve.
Yeah.
Good picture of you guys.
Yeah.
Where were you guys at?
It was the series rap party for Totally Biased with W. Kamau Bell. I used to work on that show.
You were on that show.
I was
right?
on that right. show. Yes, I was a writer on the show, and I also performed on that show. And that was, we had gotten canceled.
Tell everybody what a rap party means.
A rap party is when, if it's a season rap party, it's just a party where you're wrapping up the season, and you know people have, you know, you have a party. Or if the series is ending, you have a series ending rap party. Same thing. You're wrapping it up and you're having a party. That's basically it. So it was our series rap party for Totally Biased, which I missed that show, man. We shot that in 2012 and 2013.
Okay.
Yeah. It was
you had fun on it?
I did, man. It was challenging, but it was also fun. And you know how sometimes things become more fun the further away you get from having done it. It's like, oh, you know, you missed things that you didn't think you would miss. So it was like that. Chris Rock was the producer of that show. So, and then W. Kamau Bell, my good friend, it was his show. And to his credit, Kamau's a cat I met in Chicago as well. But he told me, man, if I ever get a TV show, you're going to be on it. Now, how many times have you heard that, George? Probably a million times in life. And whoever does it, nobody.
Yeah.
But he was one of the rare cats that he actually got a show and he actually put me on it. So, you know, can't ask for more than that.
He came through.
Yeah, he came through. He came through. So I'm actually going to fly out. He hasn't done stand-up in over 5 years, just with the family stuff and the Rona and everything. But he's starting to do stand-up again. And he's out in Oakland. I'm going to fly out there and do some shows with him.
Nice, nice. And I was like with Steve, like Steve was had that room and a lot of people came through.
Oh, yeah.
Jetta Jones, Lance, first time came to where you
were crowded, right?
You and Lance,
yes.
Yeah.
Who also wrote Lance from Chicago? Lance is from Chicago as well. Yeah. Lance is from Chicago. Lance and the brother who you saw in the sketch who was driving the car, they were in the sketch comedy group together, Mary Wong. I met them all around the same time. And there was another brother.
Mary Wong stands up, right? Mary Wong is she's a stand-up, no?
No, Mary Wong was the name of the comedy group. It was brothers, black brothers from Chicago, but their collective name was Mary Wong. That's what they called themselves. And then,
okay.
Yeah. And then there was a brother named Tim Miller who was also in the group who just passed away, man, a couple of weeks ago. So I just want to, rest in peace to Tim. And also, I mean, not to get it, on a glum note, but my father, man, passed away December 22nd. So I just want to.
My condolences.
Thank you. Thanks, George. I appreciate you, man. Yeah. But yeah, man. So I met those cats in Chicago, and like you said, Lance used to do the West End. Like you said, Chris, I think, went up and did some spots, and who used to go up?
Jetta Jones.
Yeah, Jetta. She did it. John Stewart, man, used to go up there.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, John Stewart has been up and went up at the West End.
I think I know David Tell.
David Tell.
Dave did it, and then. I know Reggie McFadden,
John Leguizamo.
Well, John, I used to see around, like he used to do like a lot of the rooms, like mostly magic, like when we were working out, I'd see John. And matter of fact, he is. This is Steve here with. Alfred Hitchcock thing, and here he is with Rosie.
Yeah,
Rosie Perez.
Yeah.
And this is
it's John.
Him and John.
Yeah.
John, and he was a lot of people don't know. John did comedy, stand up, but a lot of people that they ply their trade, as stand ups and then acting. He had a female, he used to be with him, and they used to, play off of each other and do their thing. I seen him at Mostly Magic,
right?
A few rooms around town,
right.
And he was good, but he was approachable. He was a guy, he didn't have an air about him like when I met him and was around him, that kind of thing. He was cool, very talented, of course.
Yeah,
and
of course.
Steve, I wanted to show a clip of Steve.
Okay.
What he looks like. This is his reel. This is his acting reel. This is Steve Solis, everybody. And Steve is a very talented and gifted not only actor, writer, producer as well, directs, and terrific and very, very funny stand-up. I used to always get on him about doing a lot of time in between acts. That was his thing.
Yeah.
Steve's going to do Steve. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? It was like a mini concert in between, bringing up, like, yo, man, I got to be someplace. Steve. Come on, man. We didn't give a fuck.
It's almost breakfast time.
It's almost breakfast, man. This is his reel.
When I voted for Obama in 2008, I weighed 250 pounds. Now I weigh 350 pounds. That's not the kind of change I was hoping for.
Come on, I want you to teach me.
What makes you think I'll teach you?
Because if you don't, I'll tell the cops.
Is that what you want to become? A con man, a thief like me? Is that what you want? Okay, let's go, Jose.
It's my profession. My art. It's what I do. And it's one thing you can't do in this business is lose your touch. Because once you do that, they got you.
I raise you 300. Too rich for me. I'm out.
You know I'm starting that Boy Scout troop, right? Dwayne Kennedy, damn it! Dwayne Kennedy! Now free on Spotify. He'll bring the funny. Get rid of all that depression. Dwayne Kennedy.
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
I could care less about politics. And I'm tired of the media making me feel guilty for not voting. That's why I choose Voter Tussin.
You know what?
What?
He made sure to let people know Dwayne can bring the funny. You know, he definitely had to throw that in. That's what's up.
Yeah.
You know,
appreciate it.
Because that's real.
Yeah. That's my boy.
But this is, yeah, no doubt. This is your gig. All right. Come one, come all. That's January the 20th. Which is this Saturday, 7 p.m.
Yeah.
And a special guest, 990. Let me put the address up here. It's Columbus. Let's see where it's at. 990 Columbus Avenue. Is that correct? Between 108th and 109th, 212-222-0259, 7 p.m. show. It's an early show. You get in, and then you'll be glad you did, because this brother here, I'm talking about Dwayne Kennedy, is well worth the price of admission and then some. And it's sometimes it's not even about that. You know, it is and it isn't at the same time,
mm-hmm.
because you get a chance to really see, you know, what stand-up is about, what real comedy is about. Brother that writes, that understands, you know, what the game is, and to learn from the best, you can tell, you know, by I coach football and sports as well.
Okay.
And a friend of mine's coach who I work with, who, you know, actually, you know, and he always says, be a student of the game.
Mm.
Huh?
Yeah, yeah.
And I take that to heart. And, you know, like I listen to comedy all day, be it like some of Red Fox. I have the Alexa app, and she'll, you know, I just say, Alexa, Red Fox, you know, let me read. And then some of Red Fox is when he's in the club, just doing his thing, just riffing.
Okay.
It's just incredible. Yeah. You know, just off the cuff, just, he's just, you know, his voice and the whole thing, he's taking people apart, and he's doing, you know, bits and stuff, and oh, they're just old jokes. You know, he comes from that school, like with Skillet and Leroy, and Wanda Page. You know, you hip to Skillet, Leroy, and them cats. And,
yeah.
Yeah. You know.
Pig Meat Markham and.
Oh man, okay. Yeah. Just the whole gamut.
Yeah.
You know, because I did a whole thing like with, you know, with like with the Black Comics with Timmy Rogers, and they used to get on Timmy used to always say, like, the Pygmy Markham, yo man, you need to, like, with the black, because a lot of those comics used to go on stage with blackface.
Mm.
Yeah, black comics doing blackface.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? And so Pygmy Timmy was like, yo, Pygmy, you need to, you know, dress up and the whole thing. You don't dress or anything. He said, well, man, you know, you dress in the whole thing. He said, but ain't nobody going to see you on the radio. Huh? You know, but incredible. But I was talking before about like white rooms and black rooms.
Mm-hmm.
I played both. You know, where am I more comfortable at? I'm comfortable on stage
mm-hmm.
in front of an audience, period, point blank. Mm-hmm. Be they black or white, my material doesn't alter.
Mm-hmm.
I do the same. I'm in the right here in the middle of the road. I'm keeping it, as they say, real. You know, I'm giving you me.
Mm-hmm.
When you see me upstage, you see me. When I see you, I see you.
Mm-hmm.
It would, but you're incredibly clever, incredibly, you know, gifted, you know, and your wordsmith, how you put it together and how, you know, you do what you do. And it's a blessing. It's a gift. It's what did Jay say? A gift and a curse. It's not a curse in this sense. It's a gift because you hit the point. You hit the nail all the time. I just want to show I love this here. Let me get this caption out of the way so we can get it clear. How's those clips coming out? Are they, you know, are they, you know, smooth? Or, yeah. Because from
as I can tell,
it's okay. Good.
Yeah.
Let me move this out of the way. Hide that. And then I want to play this clip of Dwayne Kennedy. This is funny. Oh, yes.
Let white folks have it, man. Just right out the gate. Just, you know. Let me tell you something. Your pathological greed and compulsive need for control has been the single most source of pain and misery for people of color throughout this world for generations. But I try not to say things like that anymore. Because I found once you have said something like that to a white person, you almost never get a second date. You know what I mean?
That's funny. You almost never get a second. You don't see that coming. That's funny.
Thanks, man.
But yeah, so, oh, no doubt. But yeah, so, you know, come on out. It's this Saturday, mm-hmm. the 20th, as I said. And it's trying to see, they have the tickets. It says to call Steve. You know, for info at 917-568-7093. And he'll break it down to you, you know, exactly what's what, all the details and the particulars and stuff. And like I said, you'll be glad you did. You'll be happy that you did, you know, to see real comedy, real stand up. You're not talking about nobody's, or mother or anything along those lines.
Nah.
Yeah, listen, man, I play some rooms, man. I know you have as well. I'll work with some of these cats, man, that just is just like brutal.
Yeah.
Brutal.
Yeah. And
you know, when I seen this Nick, God, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Hmm.
I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, I was saying when you've seen like some of these, you know, that clip I'm gonna play next. You sum it up. Yeah, I was drinking something. I spit it out. I did a spit take. It just fucked me up. I was like, you know how many guys I work with? This I work with too many of these guys. You know
those cats are they're hilarious, man. Funny for reasons they don't even realize they're funny to me.
That's amazing.
Yeah,
that's amazing. I'm going to play it, and then I'm going to talk about, you know, some of the lines you say in it, you know.
Okay.
Yeah. It's like, you know, like black rooms and it says so-called white rooms, whatever. It's just a room is a room. But, you know, some of the white rooms can be brutal, too. But here we go. This is Dwayne Kennedy breaking it down.
That was like his only hit. Different type of show than I expected, man. You know, and I'm glad, I hope it's a different type of show than you expected, you know, a bit. Because, you know what I mean? I mean, sometimes people see black comedians and stuff, and they think, oh, man, it's going to be like, I can't wait. He's going to be talking about everybody. He's going to be talking about that dude. Hey, talk about his head. Talk about that brother right there. He can't walk. Talk about him.
I don't like to do that, man. And it kills me when you see, like, black comedians will come on sometimes and they come out like, and they'll dog out the audience, but then they'll try to slip in some social commentary. Yeah, those brothers kill me. Be, like, ignorant with a message. They come out like, God damn, I'm in this motherfucking house. Look at all these motherfuckers here. Look at my, where all my niggas at? Look at all these motherfucking niggas right here. Look at this black ass bitch right here. This fucking black ass, nasty, stanky, stank, fucking nasty, fucking stank, nasty, black fucking stank, nasty black bitch right here. Fucking black, and speaking of nasty, fucking stank bitches, we got to love our sisters, because they queens. They queens. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? I know you know what I'm saying. This bald head black motherfucker right here, bubble lip motherfucker, no job having mother, government cheese receiving motherfucker, pussy eating motherfucker right here. And speaking of eating pussy, ladies and gentlemen, it's too many kids going to bed hungry at night. All right, thank you all. I'm done.
Oh boy,
he said, you know how many of those guys I work with, bro? You say ignorant with a message, ignorant with a message, and I was gonna say surprise. No, he's supposed to be here. He showed up, he's here, Steve Solis.
Oh, finally.
Oh man, you don't know what I had to go through to get here.
Oh boy.
Oh boy, I had to reset passwords, do all kinds of crap.
All right, man.
Why is that? Huh? What was that all about?
Oh, because I should have had you send it to Comedy Matters instead of Mr. Witty. That's what happened.
So that's what it was?
Yeah, so I finally turned it around. I went back. Anyways, it's not important. I'm here now. And I just saw Dwayne do my act. What the hell's going on here?
That's your stuff?
That's all your stuff.
Yeah, no, it's funny because I have a thing about rappers. You know, they go, motherfuck that, fuck this. And at the end, they go, God bless.
Well, you know who's good with that? DMX. DMX used to do a whole, you know, piece like that, you know, what you just said. Yeah.
Mm.
But a lot of these guys, they're on it. But I work with so many of those guys that Dwayne just was, you know, as a matter of fact, verbatim, like the black, big black grit. It was like, when I heard that, I'm like, oh shit, he's seen the same act too.
You know? Yeah, man. So what you got? What's going on? What you guys been talking about?
About you, basically, about you know?
Yeah.
About me?
You know? Never mind on CP time, you're on Puerto Rican time. Puerto Ricans are usually on time.
Yeah, well, you know, we got both. When black Puerto Ricans are mostly black and Puerto Rican Indian.
And Indian.
So,
you know.
Yeah, that's right. That's just funny because when I had my afro and everything, I had hair, I'd be doing all the black shows and shit. As soon as I lost my hair, oh no, you just Puerto Rican, man.
Here's an old shot of you.
Oh, yeah, the West End.
Yeah, the West End, man.
And I was talking about the West End, you know, everybody that used to come through, and Rock and Jetta Jones and McFadden. And he was telling me
Lance Crowther, Judy Gold, David Attell.
Hold up, Judy Gold came through?
Yeah,
man. Okay. There was more people. Yeah, and I was telling John Stewart used to come up there.
Yeah, John Stewart, Howie Feller, a lot of people. Kathleen Rowe.
Yeah.
Amy, I can't remember. Oh my God. She's gonna be on the show and I can't. Oh, but when I say it was Amy, oh, holy cow, I hope she doesn't see this.
Was she funny? Or is she funny?
Yeah. Yeah, she is funny. I wouldn't put her on the show if she wasn't funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. You came through there.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. I was telling Dwayne about how, like, you know, hosting, man, you used to do a mini concert in between acts.
yeah, you know, because I had that much material. You know how I was. we had 4 hours to fill it. When I was starting, there was no comics there yet. Yeah. They weren't helping me out then. I had to do a lot of material.
You had that room for 4 hours. But you know what?
We had like 20 comics.
Yeah, at least per show.
At least.
Yeah. That's where Steve and I met, man. I was out here from Chicago and I was looking for some places to go up, and I got the Village Voice, and I was looking through the Village Voice, and it said the Paranoid Players with Steve Solis at West End on Mondays and Tuesdays.
Yeah, West End Cafe. Then it was later on became West End Gate. Yeah. And then it was shut down.
Yeah. Then they closed the gates. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's where I met Steve. Let me go up there and see what's going on. Signed up and started coming up there, and then we became friends. That's where I met Jetta at the West End.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But Jetta Jones, a legend in New Orleans.
Yeah.
And she had I remember her appearance, first appearance on the Apollo, Showtime at the Apollo. And she was rocking. Mm. She was killing. She was slamming.
Yeah.
For the first 7 to 8 minutes, whatever, and then she made a mistake of like it's like it was a club, like settled in when the laughs were coming, they were coming, and she got comfortable, mm-hmm. and she settled in. You know, the Apollo, you just got to keep that your foot to the pedal.
Yeah, keep boom.
Yeah,
boom.
That's it.
But that wasn't the actual show. She did that, right?
No, that was the show when she got. She didn't get booed, but it was like
I don't think she ever did the TV show.
She did the TV. I saw it.
We did other shows there. I used to do a show there every Tuesday night for about a year
at the Apollo.
At the Apollo with Bubba Ice. Who else? Yeah, a lot of people were there. It was a Tuesday night at the Apollo, and then it became the Apollo Comedy Hour.
Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah.
I
know with. When they started doing the Apollo, when they were going around with Don Winer, Sarah Smith, those people, Chuck Sutton, and I met, we do an audition with Monteria Ivy, right? Talent was there, Chappelle, but Chappelle was like 15, 16, just coming from D.C., you know, because I was coming out of the bathroom, and he's going in the bathroom, and he said, "Hey, man, you almost knocked me down," you know, I was coming out. But he was a young dude, and you know, and that's tall and the whole thing. But you know, that was the auditions that I was at the Strip, you know, that time.
Oh, yeah,
okay.
And Don Winer, half Jewish, half Chinese, he was half Jewish, half Chinese, right? Yeah, and he promised again, like you were saying before, they promise you the world. "Oh, George, don't worry. You know, you got the feature, da da da. You don't have to worry about that amateur spot." It still ended up, I didn't get the feature. He gave me he threw me with the amateur. It was a minute 30 seconds, like 700. And I said, "Well, you know what? I can handle that." Thank God I didn't get booed, you know. Mm-hmm. But they had their whole, you know, a crew. Basically, they were, you know, going to Cali. You did the Apollo, Lance? Did you do the feature?
Lance?
No, I'm sorry, Dwayne.
I did it. Yes, I did.
He did the feature.
That's what I just asked him. Yeah.
I auditioned at the Apollo upstairs. I think it was in that room, some room upstairs. Okay, and they said I got it. They said, "But we're gonna put you on as a, you know," it was for the amateurs. I didn't realize it was that.
And I said, hey, man, I don't want to go on as an amateur. I want to go on as a feature.
Right.
They said, well, just do this and let's see what happens. So I auditioned and they were going to book me as an amateur. I said, no, I don't want to do that. They said, well, if you want to go on as a feature, you have to audition again. So I auditioned at Dangerfield.
Okay.
Yeah. And then I got that. Yeah. So
who was it? Was it Sarah Smith and Chuck Sutton, those people?
It was Sarah Smith. And it was funny because I could not remember her name until you mentioned it. I believe it was Sarah Smith. I know. No, you know what? No. I auditioned for, what's my man?
Chuck Sutton?
No.
That Chuck Sutton kid suck my dick.
Oh, dang, bro.
I'll tell you why in a minute.
Camacho,
what's his name?
Macho Camacho.
Tony Camacho.
I auditioned with Tony Camacho.
That was Rick Messina's boy at that time, I think.
Yeah, so I auditioned for him.
Oh, well, they were actually partners for a while.
They were partners at Dangerfields, yeah.
You know? Okay, yeah. So he's the one that called me and told me that I had gotten the gig. You know, hold on a second. I've got to plug my computer in before it dies.
Is that special that I seen Dwayne's Showtime thing? I saw Messina, you know, help produce that, right? You know, and I know him and Camacho. I think Camacho was managing Kim Fields. You know, I was in Cancun, Mexico with Ronnie Wilkerson. And Jimmy came in the last week I was there. And he was telling me about he was managed. Camacho was managing him at that time. You know, So Tony's had it there. So I'll wait for Dwayne to come back and ask him, did Tony manage him? Did Messina get a?
Well, you know, I don't know if the people really want to hear about this management, you know, yeah, he went on to manage Drew Carey. This is Messina. Went on to manage Drew Carey and
Tim Allen.
And Tim Allen and stuff. He, you know, they were million-dollar people there. By you know, they turned into million-dollar people and stuff. But
all right, I'm back.
Yeah. Dwayne, did I say Amy Fisher? Was that the last name I used?
Amy Foster.
Amy Foster. Thank goodness. Because Amy Fisher's that woman they tried to kill, what's his name? Bonifico's wife.
Right.
Thanks.
He's on the show?
Yeah, she's going to be on the show, Amy Foster and Kathleen Rohl, which was, both came from. Amy Fisher, I don't know. She's jail. So I don't know where she is.
No, she's been out.
Yeah, who cares? Anyway.
The Long Island Lolita.
Yeah. He put everything on her. It was him. He was trying to kill his wife.
Yeah.
Allegedly, just in case, you know.
Yeah.
So tell that story you were going to say.
What was I talking about? Oh, no. So then, this Tony Camacho called me, told me that I got it, and then I went on as a feature. So that was cool. But then I worked with that woman, Sarah Smith, I think. At some point, I was in touch with her. You know, just back and forth. Yeah. But that's it. Yeah.
So, Steve, you said people are not interested in, they like the backstory. They like
But Camacho, they're not going to know who those guys are. We know because we're comics, but
you don't. Yeah, but with Rick Messina, because I saw Messina had, when I saw your special, Dwayne.
Yes.
Right? He was on the production he produced it.
And he produced it, and then I wound up being represented by him. So that special was it was a combination of you got the special and then you got a development deal with Showtime. So it was like six of us. It was me, Patrice O'Neill, this cat named Mark Lundholm, Gary Goldman, Charlie Vericola, and a cat named Steve. Got his last name. But we all had, it was six of us. So we got those specials. And then, like I said, we got the special and then they got a development deal. But none of the development deals turned, you know, nobody, it didn't turn out to get a show from it. But we were just working with writers trying to get a show on Showtime. But, you know.
Yeah, but the development deal, with the development deal, didn't you do like 227 and all that stuff?
No, that was before. That was years before when I first went out of LA. I auditioned for 227 because it was like the last days of like the last seasons, you know, and they start adding characters trying to boost the ratings, and they had Stoney Jackson was they had added him to the cast. Stoney Jackson and what's my man? Comedian, what's his name, Steve? You know what I'm talking about. Barry Sobel. George, you know Barry Sobel? You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, you know what you're talking about.
Yeah. So he used
to rap. Barry used to do the raps.
Yeah. Yeah.
He do the thing about nationalities. Yeah, sure, sure. Chinese people can drive. Sure, you know, like that.
Right. All that right. stuff. Yeah. So they had added him to the cast. And they were looking for somebody to play his roommate, and they had cast Stoney Jackson, but they didn't like Stoney Jackson. Oh man, where are we at? I think my.
Well, now we lost him. It's me again. Yeah, no man. I'm sure he's trying to charge it up. So, you want me to tell you my Apollo story?
Yeah.
Well, I got the feature thing. I auditioned, right? And then everybody's getting booed. And they said, Steve, can you do the amateur? Because, you know, you never get booed at the Apollos. And I said, I don't know if I want to do that. And my sister said, I asked her for her advice. She said, do it, because you don't know when this show could only last two or three more episodes. And that's it. Is you one big shot at doing regular TV, you know, and he talked me into it, and I went on, and I was doing great, but I was getting booed after every joke. They laugh and then booed. I found out later one of the other contestants' mother paid like 100 people, you know, they get it for free. She paid 100 people $1 to boo me.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I didn't even know. So I'm going, I do a thing, I get a laugh, and then I hear booze. I get a laugh, and then I hear booze. And then I was doing a Jesse Jackson. I was doing a Jesse Jackson joke, and that was it. They started booing, and then the Sandman came out, and I had my chucks because I was going to do the Fat Ninja routine, and I didn't let him get near me. As I walked off the stage, he's coming towards me, so he couldn't put the thing around me. But I should have hit them so they never show that spot. Because people who didn't see it just think I sucked. No, I had laughs, then the booze. Laughs, and then the booze. You know, so it was one of the worst experiences I've had. At least I got paid $900. I heard years later they didn't pay any of these contestants unless they went three or four times in a row.
I never heard that they got paid.
I got paid.
No, I'm talking about the guys that came later on. Mm-hmm. I got paid. I was one of the first groups that was involved with it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the initial payment was like seven and change. Then you did they showed the repeat.
Yeah, I'm talking about way later, like recently, that they didn't get paid.
Oh, right.
I don't know if it was union. I don't know what the deal was. But I said, what? They're going to go on national TV and not get, I didn't get it, you know.
Right.
So,
can you see me or hear me at all?
Yeah, I can see you now
and hear you.
Okay, yeah. Great.
But you got to move
it. Died.
Oh, you on the phone?
Yeah.
Hold it up a little higher, because it's going. You're going from down angle.
I don't care.
All right. Well, you look weird. Anyway, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, you're like. Like that. I don't know. Anyway. Yeah. So, Yeah, we're doing this show. You guys talk about it, yeah?
Yeah, that's all we've been talking about.
Oh, yeah? Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm out of the loop, man. Speaking out of the loop, Dwayne has a movie that's on Apple TV, a documentary about Chicago comics called Out of the Loop.
Oh, yeah.
And you can check it out there, and you can check it out for free on Tubi, I think it is.
Yeah.
Tubi. What's the deal with Tubi? What's Tubi about?
Tubi, it's a free app. You have some commercials and stuff, but it's you see a lot of movies and shows for free.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody told me that Tubi's...
So you can sign up. You don't even have to really even leave your information and stuff. And you once you sign up, you can start just watching the movies. So it's a good deal. You have to watch some commercials, but you know.
Yeah.
You can. Is it anything like Hulu?
No, it's not up to Hulu. Hulu has its own content and big movie. You know, it's Hulu's a little more prestige, but Tubi will get those movies after Hulu gets them.
Yeah. It's up to you, though, if you choose to watch it. You know, it's like to be or not to be.
You know, that's a good question.
I couldn't What's let that? It go, Bob. I couldn't yeah, let I it know. Pass. I should... Oh, yeah.
Who are these two freaks?
Right. I don't know.
Good question.
I don't know. But it looks like somebody needs to put them out of their misery. Table.
Right.
I like those frames, Steve.
Oh, thanks. My sister said they look gay or like your grand. You know, she's always That's had something nice,
you,
something
you look
nice
like your
to say.
Grandmother.
Nah, man, those are hip.
Yeah.
And the word hip brings me to tells about my age. I don't think anybody uses hip anymore, do they?
I don't think they
nah,
anyway.
It depends on what circle you're in. But yeah, so I want to, Steve, you were late, and I wanted, to, but you were here, but you're here.
Yeah, I was here. I just couldn't get, you know, what I had to, I don't even want to talk about what I had to do. I had to suck somebody's dick to get on here.
Okay. And you're going to have to suck another one to get
off. Just kidding, just kidding.
But you got to suck to get off, too.
Yeah. No, a crackhead was walking by, and I said, do you know something about computers? He said, yeah. So I had to suck his dick to get to get on this show.
But, you were late.
Yeah, of course I was late. I almost didn't make it, man. I was like, oh boy. I mean, you know, I have three computers and I wind up on my phone.
Are you on your phone as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
See, yeah, I can do the 3D thing. See,
yeah,
yeah.
Well,
so all right, this is what it is. You guys are hitting this Saturday, the 20th.
Right.
Promote it, sell it, and then leave what you want to leave as far as like social medias and the whole thing. And Steve, you missed a great show.
Oh well, good. You know, I know Dwayne would. I know Dwayne could step it up, man. I did the show. I did the show with you by myself last time. So, you know, that's of course, it would be funny with me on there too. But you know,
right?
You know, it's all right. It's all right. We're gonna have to put a gun to your head to bring us back again.
Oh, most definitely. I mean, if. I'd love to have you back, and then
literally, George,
you're gonna bring us back.
Literally,
you're but gonna you bring us back. Well, you know, like, you sort of have to have one. I think you sort of have to have one. You know.
So this is Dwayne, Steve, and Dwayne's Comedy Fiasco with special guests. You name, but it was a what was her name?
Kathleen Rohl and
Amy Foster.
Amy Foster. I don't know why I'm stuck because I keep remembering I have like five friends named Amy. It's really bugging me. So yeah, Amy Foster was one of my. I've known them both over 35 years.
Wow, man. Yeah, brother. Woo. Time is flying. Where is it going? Where are we going?
I know, right?
Yikes. Yeah, I met him when I was 10.
Yeah.
You're right. We met as zygotes.
And I know this is your favorite here, Steve.
Is that you with asthma or something? What the hell is that?
That's the rim shot.
I know. Hey, man, you don't use rim in anything, man.
Hey, thanks for having us, man.
God bless you. Thank you for gracing and blessing my platform. I appreciate it. And like I said, Steve, you missed an incredible show. But you already know. I mean,
yeah, you know, it would have just been me talking about me, so that's cool. Yeah, I missed it, but I'm sure you guys did a great job. And a lot of people, they must know you do a lot of impressions, right?
Me?
No, George.
Oh, George, I was going to say.
No, they don't know.
Oh, yeah.
They don't know.
He does incredible impressions. You should have a show where you just do some of your impressions, man.
Well, but then I have to bring you back, and we do like...
Hey, we could do match Dooley, Mike Tyson,
And impression
stuff
off.
Like that.
Yeah. Mike Tyson talk like this, The reason I talk this way is because the muscles are squeezing my throat, A lot of people say I hit Robin. It's not true. If I hit Robin, she looked like Whoopi Goldberg.
Oh, man.
Where's the rim shot?
No! Don't do it! Oh, man. comics hate that, George. You should know that. They hate that.
No, but you know what? I do the Jackie Mason
shit. Yeah, I hate Jackie Mason, too. That dude owes me money.
Jackie Mason?
Yeah, I wrote some jokes. He never even paid me. This is before when he made his comeback. We used to hang out at this place called Silver Star on 2nd Avenue. It's a big diner. Mm-hmm. And he'd go in there. We became friends and stuff, But then, what happens.
Mm. Wow. Yeah.
I know his daughter. She's a comic. She's doing pretty good right now.
Okay.
She used to have a couple of rooms.
Yeah,
what's her name?
The daughter. We didn't get along. Him and the daughter never got along.
Well, pretty much didn't, pay it. It was like she's not but it was his daughter. But he was, it was estranged.
Okay.
Karen wants to know what my best impression is. It's whatever is that they're laughing at the time.
I know that's right.
What do I like to do? Whoever. Mm-hmm. The Jackie Mason thing is good. And Tyson, I do the old school stuff that is outdated, but I bring it back when I got fillers and stuff like that. But Cosell and Ali, I do a wicked Cosell. But nobody knows who Cosell is in this generation. They don't have a clue.
Man. Well, so I'm gonna have to say you're right about that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nobody knows.
Yeah. That. Well, my favorite right now is was Obama. We're gonna solve the BP issue, the health issue. And you see my wife? I'm gonna tap that ass. But Obama. But my all time one, of course, is Humphrey Bogart. But of course, most movie buffs know, but most people don't even know who he is now.
Man, these people.
No, this generation.
They don't even know anything past last Thursday.
That's sad. But I appreciate you too. I thank you humbly.
Thank you.
And again, the January 20th at 7 p.m., 990. I had it up there. Columbus Avenue between, 190th and 180th.
No, it's good. On Columbus Avenue, right? It's between 109th Street and 108th Street on Columbus Avenue.
On Columbus Avenue. Thank you.
Yeah.
690 Columbus.
Yeah. 990
Columbus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you, man.
Karen is a funny lady.
No
doubt. And
appreciate you.
All right, man.
All right.
Take care.
Any
care.
And stuff.
All right.
Drop.
All right now.
All right.
All right.
All right, cool. Thank you. All right. Steve Solis and Dwayne Kennedy. Thank you.
Hey, how do I get off?
There you go. So that was good. That was the way they have the gig coming up on the this Saturday, the 20th. Let's play them out there. They got, here it is. It's through their flyer as I play them out. It's Steve and Dwayne's Comedy Fiasco with special guests. January 20th, 2024, 7 p.m. at 990 Columbus Avenue, New York, New York, between 108th and 109th Street, 212-222-0259. And they're both very, as I said, very funny and very talented. And I want to thank them for that, for blessing me, my platform, and from insightfulness and just funny guys, funny and good people, good down to earth individual. Karen was wanted to be funny with me. Oh, what is your best impression? She asked me, is it being a comedian? Ooh, where's the boo button at? Boo. I got a boo on that. That's really bad. Karen, you are uninvited to the barbecue. Yes. But it's all good. It's all in fun. Entertaining show, Karen says. Thank you. I appreciate that. And on that note, I'm going to leave you temporarily for now anyway and play you out. How do I play you out? I play you out. But, yeah, so I thought it was a good show. I thought it was very entertaining. And stay safe. Enjoy your 2024 holiday. It was Dr. King's birthday on the 15th. We celebrate Dr. King and his legacy. And we still have a long way to go as far as like what he wanted to accomplish and what we as a people, the human race, need to accomplish. And also, tell your loved ones that you love them. Embrace them. Hug them, all right? And you can't be wrong if you're in the right. So always do the right thing or try to do the right thing. Some people don't know what the right thing is, huh? But stay positive, all right, fellow folks? And I want to say God bless you. Peace. Be safe. Thank you for tuning in. Yo. Huh? Steve Solis, Dwayne Kennedy, everybody. God bless you and thank you.